Good morning, everyone.
It's, as always, a real privilege for me to greet you all. And of course, to thank Alan and to tell you, perhaps I won't find the time later on, that Pesach obviously will mean a break, a couple of weeks, because Pesach happens on Sundays. And so we hopefully, Im Yirtzeh Hashem, get together again right after Pesach with hopefully many insights about the Bible and all the other wonderful celebrations that come up after Pesach. I know that it's for some of you who've read the little blurb that I sent out last week. And so you'll know that we're going to do some love poetry today. And the day is perfect for it because it's a spring day. And of course, Song of Songs is all about love and spring and quite a bit of eroticism. I'd like to tell you what I'm starting with though. I want to start with, you know, everyone's very, very busy shopping. And I'm going to start with two shopping lists, two of them. And yeah, so this coming Shabbat, just to remind you, is the Shabbat before Pesach. So it's always called Shabbat Hagadol, and we'll look at that briefly. And in addition to that, we're talking about kosher. What kind of kosher am I talking about? Last week, we did talk a little bit about kidneyot. Today, I'd like to speak about speech that becomes kosher. Kosher speech is speech that is free of expressions that are beneath our dignity. So there are words that reflect humility and modesty and loving kindness. That's kosher speech. And so just to complete the idea, I wanted to tell you, kosher speech is the tool for preventing and neutralizing the anger, the bitterness, the jealousy that commonly exist between many people. We know that. And the benefits for oneself and for others make kosher speech a win-win choice. So I'd like to just mention that in addition to everything else, those who are going to make sure their devices are closed, they actually have 3 days for that. Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. The devices, various devices will be closed. So that I think minimizes the opportunity to use speech in a way that's not acceptable. So that's, imagine how that happens. And what's kosher speech? It's our way of making sure that what comes out of our mouth is just as important, if not more so, than what goes into our mouth. Kosher speech, and we are concerned about that. What about the food that I thought, in case you're going shopping very soon, whenever, I'm going to suggest a couple of things to put on the table that will help you because, you know, people are very anxious to get to the meal. What does the book by Ron Wolfson suggest? And here are some questions to start with. And the first question is, who should have a kiddush cup? Who should have a kiddush cup? You know, it's not Shabbat. It's not like Shabbat. Everyone who participates in the Seder should have his or her own wine. Everyone has a kiddush cup. And that's a requirement of the Seder. And we all participate, as you know, or partake of 4 cups of wine. So everyone has a kiddush cup. And who recites the kiddush? And how do we stand? Do we sit? All of these questions, right? The leader of the Seder does generally recite the kiddush. And traditionally, obviously, it is the father, but not necessarily so. And of course, this year, a lot of things are changing. You probably have thought about that many, many times. So the kiddush is obviously the way that the kiddush for Shalosh Regalim, for the 3 festivals, and we're going to say, boy, play hagafen. The kiddush, standing or sitting, depends on your minhag, depends on what you people do. The rabbis were undecided on this point. You're not surprised, right? And some people say, my minhag is to stand and my minhag is to sit. And while this might seem strange, remember that the Seder is a banquet and we are the guests of honor. And so we're expected to spend most of the feast sitting, but also reclining. Remember, reclining is a symbol of freedom. And if you've taken all, you know, your cushions, your pillows to the Seder table, why not? Even if you're inclined to say the Kiddush while standing, you should sit down and then lean on your left. So who's going to fill up your cups? Again, it may be different in 2021, but generally, why do we have other people filling our cups? Well, it's a sign of people who are free. In ancient times, of course, people had servants. And so the servant would be, or maybe another person would be filling the cup. So you don't actually fill your own cup. It is a lovely custom to have participants fill each other's cups with wine. It may be juice, by the way, but it is the reminder of nobility of a free people. For those people who cannot handle so much wine, I'm going to just tell you how much in a minute. Why do we lean to the left? Well, most people are right-handed, and those people who are right-handed lean to the left so that they can be using their hands. And how much wine? How much wine? Is that a real question? Well, the sages have decided that there's a certain amount that we should put into our cups. We may just not drink all of it, only the most of it. And so how much? Well, 3.3 fluid ounces. 3.3 fluid ounces is to be drunk each of the four times that we require to drink a cup. Of course, the cups that we drink is about the four, even five expressions of redemptions, ve'hotzeti, ve'hitzati, ve'ga'ati, ve'lakachti, which of course is in Exodus. And he continues, that's Rabbi Wolfson, since this would result in a substantial amount of wine, it was determined that if you drink only most of it, like two-thirds of it, then you have fulfilled the mitzvah. And obviously for children, that would mean juice. It could easily be mixed with water because after a while, that's a lot of wine. And what if someone cannot drink wine? Well, of course, everything is for the sake of our well-being. And for the head of the house, there is a wonderful opportunity to show up in white. That white robe, if you like, is called a kittel. And it's a way to really mark this wonderful, wonderful holiday. Now, what about the shopping that I mentioned before? You might want to consider that as well. You know, it does get very late. If you're starting on time, it's very late and the clock has moved. And Rabbi Wolfson is mentioning about the kalpas. Kalpas obviously is a vegetable. So it's defined as a fruit of the earth, right? Pri ha'adama. And in Eastern Europe, because green vegetables were rare, so boiled potatoes were used, and you may still have that wonderful custom in your home. The Shulchan Aruch recommends many are accustomed to take parsley, but it is best to take celery, which also has a good taste. And it is best of all to take radishes. I wonder how many people are thinking, yes, we have radishes at our table. It's best of all to take radishes. Any of the above is fine. And of course, you could have vinegar, but most people use salt water, which is reminiscent of the tears. So we dip all of that. That the innovations that he's suggesting, that is Rabbi Wolfson, he's suggesting a wonderful innovation. Because it's an opportunity for those who really wish to eat something because they're getting hungry and maybe impatient, and that's very, very natural. So they can't wait for dinner, and therefore, says Rabbi Wolfson, serve plates full of kalpas appetizers. Like what? Well, celery, carrots, parsley, radishes, broccoli, along with obviously salt water. That helps everyone sort of feel that they're okay before dinner, because dinner may be very, very late, depending on how much discussion there is, depending on how many songs you sing, right? Ilu Hotzianu Mimitzrayim, all kinds of songs. Now that's an interesting innovation, that on your table, there'll be more than just one or two pieces of celery, but a whole variety of vegetables, which is great. Now, of course, in this Haggadah and in all Haggadot, there would be a little part that we mustn't forget. I spoke about Kiddush, but Kiddush for the first night is different, a little different, because it's Motzei Shabbat. It's the end of Shabbat, and therefore we add Havdalah. So it's a transition, right? And so it's not going from Kodesh Lechol, but it's going from Kodesh LeKodesh, if you like. So it's sanctified time to another sanctified time, right? From Shabbat into the Chag. So it's a Yom Tov festival. And therefore, when Pesach falls on Saturday night, there's a slightly abbreviated and a little bit of a different version of the Havdalah ceremony. And that's part of the Kiddush, because obviously we've already lit candles. And so the Kiddush, well, we always make a Kiddush over wine. And the first opportunity to make the distinction between Shabbat and Yom Tov, second, we're already reciting the blessing for wine, which is the very first blessing of the regular Havdalah ceremony. There's a lot more to say, but Havdalah will be a part of it. And of course, Sheikh Hayana will be a part of the Kiddush as well. This is a wonderful volume by Rabbi Ron Wolfson, and among the many wonderful Haggadot that I've got. I'm moving very quickly because I want so much to also discuss the Song of Songs and maybe have an opportunity to sing with you. What I'd like to stop for a moment, and I know that everyone loves to talk about the Rasha. I'm jumping to the four children because I've just heard a new lecture and with a new interpretation. You know, this is the whole story. It's about interpretation. There aren't only right answers. There are many answers, many answers. And the Seder is wonderful. Last week we spoke about Rabban Gamliel and his pronouncements and the fact that he put together a Haggadah. Why is that? Well, you know, it's an important point. You know, at that time, when the sages were sitting in Yavne and some of them in Bnei Brak, there was a lot of concern. And I think that we know that. There were issues because there wasn't a temple and somehow the third temple wasn't being built. There was a lot of discussion. And in this Haggadah, which is the Haggadah from the Rabbinical Assembly, it's again about Rabban Gamliel, and they're saying the rabbis were concerned. Is Pesach still meaningful if there's no korban, if there's no sacrifice? Is it still meaningful? Remember that the only time there really wasn't a korban is the 40 years in the wilderness. They did not bring a sacrifice. But then once they came into the land, then there were sacrifices. And that was a major part, that the Pesach Matzah Maror. Pesach means the sacrifice. So it says Pesach Matzah Maror, when the temple was destroyed, the task of the rabbis was to prove that the spirit of Pesach was indestructible. We understand that today, but 2000 years ago, it wasn't so clear. They were very, very worried, we said, about the unity, the way that the nation will eventually develop without independence, without a country. All of that was worrisome for the sages. So is the spirit of Pesach indestructible? And they reinforced the loaded symbolism of the Seder. And that's why we have so many things on the Seder plate that are symbolic. And they authenticated the signs of God's involvement in the history of our people. We talked last week about, you know, the unity and the community, that it's so important for us. All of these things continue to be very meaningful, although I know we're going to make some adjustments this year. This is an important idea. will Pesach continue to be meaningful? And as you know, when we look at the four children, there's a problem with that, isn't there? And I'd like to stop for a moment and tell you that at Pesach time, we always need to remember the in 1943, what happened. Even though it's a long time, that was a major moment. Erev Pesach 1943. Just share this memory with me. Erev Pesach 1943, the battle of the Warsaw Ghetto started on the first night of Pesach.
We saw the city in blazes. We knew that we cannot possibly win.
An army of ordinary citizens fighting the Nazis to save their city.
The battle went from street to street, from house to house, day and night.
The Americans and the British left them on their own.
There was a sense of frustration and injustice that was quite strong.
Their loss was catastrophic. But their story was never told.
Somehow, in history books, there's very little of it.
Thousands and thousands of people that died in the name of freedom, in vain.
Against the massed might of the Nazi war machine, although the flames have long been extinguished, the embers still smolder. For pharaohs come and pharaohs go. The Sancheribs, the Belshazzars, the Hamans, but the freedom fighters of the ghetto will live forever. Fiery testimony to the love of liberty that was kindled by the Exodus. Once more, the covenant people have kept the faith. And so we want to remember them. In this volume, which you may just love, you may just have it on your shelf, it's quite wonderful because there are lots of little anecdotes and a lot of meaningful commentary, you know, whether it's about Rabban Gamliel or whether it's simply about the miracle of our survival. Me'avdut lechayrut, me'agon lesimcha. And we say that we often express gratitude. And in the Haggadah, there's a lot of that, even though we start from Avadim Hayinu. I'd like to read to you, with you, Lefechach Anachnu Chayavim. Let me read the English. It's very meaningful because we thank God for the miracle that happened and continues to happen. We must revere and exalt and extol and acclaim and adore and glorify God who performed all these miracles. I know you may be thinking, I just jumped from the Warsaw Ghetto to a different miracle. And I know that this is part of our history. And we all know that there's a lot of suffering, but there's a lot of thanksgiving. There are miracles for our ancestors and for us. And so he took us from slavery to freedom, from despair to joy. Me'avdut lechirut, me'agol lesimcha, me'eva le'yom tov, me'afela le'or gadol, u'mishibud li'geula, ve'nomar lefanav shira chadasha, hallelujah. In our Seder, there are lots of psalms and there are lots of opportunities to sing and delight in the way the sages have put together this Haggadah for us. So we sing before God the new song, Hallelujah, and then we move on right into Hallel, which is actually before the meal. And so I'd like to be able to address the four sons. But most of all, I want to tell you where it says, Baruch HaMakom, Baruch Hu, Baruch Shenatan Torah Le'amo Yisrael, Baruch Hu. Baruch is stated four times. And it really means that every child is a blessing. Although these four children are interesting children, and there are such fabulous comments and a different way of assessing whether this is the same child who's moved from different stages, whether these are children in a home, maybe four children, not everyone has four, and you already know the names of these children. The biblical verses merely mention children asking or being told about the Exodus. And from these verses, the rabbis created the framework instruction. What kind of instruction? Every child needs to be told at the level that he or she understands. They're calling it pedagogic instruction. They predicated dissimilar dispositions, varying degrees of maturity, and counseled that the story of the Exodus should be geared to the attitude and the age of whoever is asking the question. So what are the different ways of addressing it? I'd like to just share a couple of them with you. And of course, you may have your own understanding of it because it is not so simple. Let's just look at a wonderful story that I have. Who are these children? Everyone focuses on the Rasha. What do they call the Rasha? They call him wicked. I think I mentioned already that I don't feel good about that. But let me tell you what Rabbi Salzman has written in the past and what are possible two meanings for this Rasha. As you know, if a Haggadah is illustrated, and many of them are, the Rasha is given a very wicked look about him, depending on when that illustration was done. Here is an idea that I think we should consider. The story is told of a Hasid. And he came to his Rebbe, bemoaning the fact that his son had become an apikoros. What's an apikoros? A non-believer. Rebbe, he said, my son, he doesn't come to the synagogue with me anymore. He mocks the dietary laws and he ridicules the Shabbat as a waste of time. What should I do? What did the Rebbe say? The Rebbe says, keep on loving him. Just keep on loving him. Even a Rasha needs to be loved. And maybe there is something for us to learn by listening to his complaints and his concerns. And then the rabbi continues, the world is filled with rage these days. And few people are willing to pay close attention to it, to this Rasha. It's easier to beat the angry person into submission than to try and understand his or her anger and where it's coming from. Anger, I would suggest, is a necessary and very real emotion. Sometimes we must be willing to listen. The Haggadah chastises the Rasha, but it also celebrates his presence at the table. Finally, Rabbi Salzman says, when we stop talking, we no longer have a relationship. Therefore, anger is unpleasant, that's true, but anger, as unpleasant as it is still a way of communicating. That's an important message. So who is this Rasha and why are we so concerned? Well, there are a couple of interesting ideas, because if you read very carefully, the words are interesting. What does the wicked one say? What does this service mean to you and not to him? Who is him? By excluding himself from the community, he denies the basis of Judaism, and therefore you have to say to him quite sharply, bluntly, sharp. This is done because of what God did for me when I left Egypt. Who are the possible examples of a Rasha? This text by Rabbi Kahn, Shlomo Kahn, says something interesting. It says, had you been there, you would not have been redeemed. And yet, he gives the example of Korach. If you recall, Korach made a lot of trouble, but he did leave Egypt and he did come along with all the people who sought freedom. And so the Rasha is mentioned as if here, so he's a different type. What does the service mean to you? Why bother with antiquated, annoying ceremonies and his counterparts in our time? Surely God wants only the heart. And my heart, I'm a good Jew. So one example, as I said before, is yes, Korach made a lot of trouble, but he did leave. He was redeemed. The other example that I listened to in an interesting class coming from Israel, actually in Hebrew, the rabbi suggested that maybe this Rasha, this wicked person, is one of those people who has been attracted by Christianity. Remember, the Jewish Christians at this time, they're increasing in numbers, and there's a problem with that because their thinking is going in a different direction. And so the rabbi suggested the Rasha, the wicked person, is probably one of the people that has decided to leave Judaism because he is attracted to the idea of a Messiah. And we already know it, that's where it says, Lachem velo lo, and then it says, the words were always difficult. And therefore it says, you may not have been redeemed because you were no longer concerned with Judaism. You may have been concerned with other ideas. And you know that that's an interesting understanding. We need to welcome everyone at our Seder, so much so that in some of my Haggadot, it says very clearly, when you open the door for Elijah, open the door for everyone to come in. Welcome everyone. And it says, don't reject. Rather, use your wise influence to bring people back to the fold. That's one way of looking at the four sons, and there are many others. I'm going to come back to that, but in the meantime, again with Rabbi Kahn, he's telling us about something called impeachment. Did you think impeachment was a modern idea? Well, impeachment is right here in the Haggadah when we're talking about another of the important Chachamim, Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah. And let me remind you what it says. It says, he feels as if, keven shivim shana, he feels as if he's 70 years old. I don't know if you noticed this very interesting little paragraph. He says, I feel like I'm 70. And it tells me something about the fact that his hair turned white. What impeachment are we talking about? Remember we mentioned last week, Rabban Gamliel from the house of Hillel? Well, the president of the yeshiva was impeached. Who is he? Rabban Gamliel. Why was he impeached by the sages? Because he had a controversy with Rabbi Joshua. I think we mentioned he's very authoritarian and very tough. He had a controversy with Rabbi Joshua, and to fill the vacancy, the sages chose neither Rabbi Joshua, because they didn't want to slight Rabban Gamliel, and they didn't choose Rabbi Akiva. Why not? Well, you may not remember, but Rabbi Akiva has ancestors who are not Jewish. He's from a family of converts. We honor him because of his scholarship, and we don't hold it against him, on the contrary. But they didn't choose Rabbi Akiva as the new head of the yeshiva. And so instead, the sages offered this presidency to Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah, who was only, according to tradition, only 18 years old. But listen to this. The rabbi's wife, he's already married, right? The rabbi's wife advised him to refuse, foreseeing a reconciliation and a reinstatement of Rabban Gamliel, which did happen. But Rabbi Elazar accepted. Why? Well, he accepted, he considered even a temporary presidency too great an honor. And then, of course, it says that night, Rabbi Elazar's hair and beard, they turned white. Why? Well, like a 70-year-old, because his appearance had to somehow match his new distinguished position. So that's keven shivim shana. For those who are looking at the Hebrew, ke means like. Like 70 years, that's the story of impeachment way back a couple of thousand years ago. So and so he's using the word impeachment. Let's continue. Wow, there's so many things. And I hope, really hope and pray that you're with me, because there's all these ideas to share. What else is very important to remember? You know that we have a few other great scholars in the Haggadah. You remember him. I mentioned Rabbi Akiva. There's Rabbi Tarfon and a few of them. What does this Haggadah suggest? The Haggadah is telling us that maybe when they got together, and it's funny because generally a Seder is with family, right? And somehow these sages got together, they seem to have had some kind of an important meeting. And there was an opportunity to discuss some important, what's important? Important is survival. It's always been that way. We're always, always working hard to make sure that our people survive spiritually, physically. And so this Haggadah is telling us that, incidentally, these scholars, Rabbi Tafon in particular, were instrumental in incorporating into the Seder service such passages as Dayenu and, of course, other blessings. Now, one hypothesis submits that the five elders were planning the revolt. Remember, in 135 of the Common Era, there was a great revolt under the leadership of Bar Kokhba. The revolt is against the Romans. These times are very, very difficult. And so the revolt under the leadership of Bar Kokhba in 135, Rabbi Akiva played a prominent role. He encouraged this revolt. There were an awful lot of people who died, 24,000 according to tradition, 24,000 of Rabbi Akiva's students. And then the students had to obviously remind these sages if the Roman soldiers were around. It's also been suggested that this was a summit meeting, a crisis to examine ways and means of dealing with a relatively unfamiliar predicament, exile. People were spread out. People were leaving the land because of the harsh conditions under the Romans, and they wanted to understand how to make sure that Jews in exile will remember and keep the traditions. That's what they're dealing with. And so it says, should they resist openly, obviously against the Romans? Should they cooperate? And how could they remain Jewish in a hostile non-Jewish environment? Now, obviously there were, the commentary continues to say, they weren't the first and they weren't the last to grapple with this same idea. We talk about it today as well, right? Before we continue, let's mention a couple of great, great sages and how the Haggadah incorporates both. So there's always a machloket, a disagreement. It's always like that because these are people who are thinking deeply into the whole story of Pesach, and they're saying, how should we fashion this Haggadah that it should really reflect our roots? Remember, because we're starting with degradation, we're starting with a low period in our history, and we're working up towards a time of great joy. And so Rav and Shmuel, who are really Babylonian sages, are talking about two different things. And I do want to tell you that the first one that's used is Shmuel of Babylonia. He said, we should start with the fact of this root experience of the fact that we were slaves in Egypt. So we do, we say, Avadim hayinu lefao b'mitzrayim. We were slaves. And then of course, Hashem brought us out. So we're telling our people's story. It's all about the narrative, and it's all about how the narrative continues to be with us as a meaningful beginning to our people. Sounds good, but Rav says, no, we need to go further back. We need to go all the way back to the time when our forefathers were spiritually enslaved to idols. They were not God-fearing people. And so Rav is going all the way back to the time when we had idols. And that's why the Haggadah will talk about Terach and Abraham, because way back then, we were people who worshiped idols. And so here is the way that the Haggadah compromises. They put in both the fact that physically we were enslaved, and the fact that spiritually, way back when, we started out as idol worshipers. And so we say, Batirach. And I'm going to probably come back again and again to the four types of children, because everyone loves this idea that we have different children and different, well, probably also different ways of focusing. I wanted, yeah, if we have time, we're going to sing. Yeah, but that always, I really do want to. Let's do one of them right now. Let's do that now because we like to. So if you're with me, and if you remember, let's just do it. Kadesh uchatz karpas yachat Magid rachza motzi matza Marok orech shulchan orech Safun barech halel nirza. Interesting that the rabbis felt that we needed to have a certain order to this wonderful ceremony that we celebrate, going from one to the next with order. And so we call it a Seder, because Seder, of course, means order. And at the very end, we will obviously have songs. Why would we have songs at the end? Because we're concerned that the children should be awake and participate. Just in case you've thought about it before, there are several people who remind us that originally the meal was earlier and then Manishtana took place. However, they noticed that after the meal, people get a little bit sleepy, and so they decided to have the Manishtana first. It's actually one question, right? Manishtana, what is different? Ma is not how, but what is different? What is different this night? So Manishtana was pushed to the beginning of our Seder because people got perhaps tired and sleepy after the meal. Let's just sing one more before we move on. Echad mi yodea. Echad mi yodea. Why do we have this? We said for the children, but look at the learning that's going on. Who is one? Hashem. Who is two? The two tablets of the law. What's about three? Three fathers, four mothers, five. Five are the books of the Torah, and six are the orders of the Mishnah, and seven are the days of Shabbat. So all of that is really a learning, a song to help people learn and enjoy. And just before we move on, what about that wonderful song about some kind of a little goat? What is the symbolism there? Now, remember that so much of our Torah is about symbolism. What about this little goat at the very end? Ve'ata shunra, a lot of it is actually in Aramaic, because people did speak Aramaic, right? And at the very beginning, we're going to address the beginning and the end are in Aramaic. One little goat my father bought for two zuzim. Two zuzim is like the two tablets. What is that about? That's the question that we're going to answer. We are steeped in history, and every one of these is a symbol for another empire that came along and conquered our people, exiled our people, oppressed all of those, the Babylonians and the Persians and the Romans and the Greeks. And finally, who comes out? Well, you and I know, the little goat. The little goat is coming out, and that's us. We are the few against the many. That's the little goat. But let's come back to that in a minute. I do want to address a couple of things from the parasha, and then we'll look at a few of the big ideas pertaining to Pesach. The part about the parasha, switch gears with me. We're looking at Torah at the moment. And then we'll make time for the Song of Songs. The parasha in this week is called Tzav. Tzav comes from the word mitzvah or tziva, and we want to address one part of it. I know that it's all about sacrifices, all about animal sacrifices. Which one is particularly meaningful in these really, really important notions of sacrifices? Well, Rabbi, the one that we're looking at is about the sacrifice that's called Todah. Todah means thank you. Once again, highlighting gratitude. It's not a national sacrifice, as Tamid was. And if you're looking at the text, I'm looking at chapter number 7, verse number 12, and it says, Im al todah. If you have an occasion to come to the temple and bring a sacrifice in which you want to express thanksgiving, todah. And when would you do that? Well, if you've been fortunate enough to come out from an illness or prison or crossing a great big desert or even after a big voyage, people would say todah. I'm going to come back to that. What is it that we do today? Nechama Leibovitz, Zichrona Livracha, talks to us about that. We come to shul, when we do, and we say hagomel, birkat hagomel. And that is an important opportunity to say that Hashem has helped me overcome a dangerous, difficult situation. And so that's birkat hagomel. One has to render thanks to Hashem, and all of that's important. And the Chama says, after an illness, because it's written, the people were afflicted on account of their sinful ways. And often, as you know, illness was connected to sin. And I know that we don't like to mention it, but there are Jewish people in prison even today, even today. But Nechama's quoting, he brought us from the darkness and the shadow of death. And therefore, let us praise the Lord for his love. So a sea voyage was also always fraught with danger. And so today we need to recite a thanksgiving. I'll read to you something I think interesting about the commentary. But here is what Rabbi Artson is saying that you might want to share. We are not bringing sacrifices, but we may just do something to mark thanksgiving. The rabbis of antiquity felt that in the coming time, all sacrifices will be annulled except for the thanksgiving sacrifice, and all prayers will be annulled except for the prayer of thanksgiving. They put so much emphasis and so much importance. Goodness and gratitude, he says, are everlasting at the very center of what it means to be a human being. We're focusing on that today a lot. The task of the Jew is to start the singing early. Singing, Hallel, Zeh Hayom Asa Hashem, praising God. Hallel means to praise. And it says, sometimes in the midst of the war, in the midst of illness and poverty, we can light up the world with the fires of our thanksgiving. And we need to do that in our specific situation right now. Life summons us to rejoice at the bonds we can form. Moments of special kindness and moments of creativity and pleasure. And a wonderful day, which of course today is delightful. Then he ends with gratitude and celebration have little to do with self-interest and everything to do with the appreciation for the sheer miracle of our lives. We open our eyes to the loveliness of the world and our ears to the symphony of life. Despite the difficulties of life, we offer thanksgiving to Hashem, and by so doing, we enhance the gift of joy in the world. A wonderful summary of why it is important to spread the joy and feel the miracle of thanksgiving. And so the commentary is talking about that as well, that in the days to come, this will continue to be our focus. We bring a todah, because sometimes we've come out of a dangerous time. We bring a todah because we've recovered. We've been released from confinement. You may know that some women say birkat hagomel after giving birth as well. And it's important to understand in time to come, there will be no sacrifices except for the offering of todah, because it's so important to express our thanksgiving. In our in our volume of Torah and Haftarah, we're going to look at very, very briefly at Shabbat Hagadol. Shabbat Hagadol. So we're not going to do the usual Haftarah. We're going to turn to the back and talk about Malachi. Malachi, according to some sages, is the same person as Ezra, but most of us believe that Malachi is the last of all the prophets, and it may or may not be his real name. What does he say that we really want to emphasize? And so Shabbat Hagadol, let me tell you what Philip Birnbaum says. And I wanted to tell you, by the way, if you were looking for a wonderful book for a gift or for yourself, the Book of Jewish Concepts by Philip Birnbaum is simply a gem. He's talking both about Shabbat Hagadol and he's talking about Shir HaShirim, the Song of Songs. And here's what he says. The Sabbath preceding the Pesach festival is the Great Sabbath. In commemoration, here's one reason. One of the reasons that are accepted. Commemoration of the great miracle that occurred on Shabbat preceding the Exodus from Egypt. It's based on the tradition that when God ordered everyone to take a lamb and prepare it on the 10th of Nisan for that offering, that's Pesach Mitzrayim in Egypt, then the Egyptians could not prevent the offering of the Egyptian deity, which is a lamb. And so that Shabbat Hagadol, according to him, some people feel that it said it's very much reminiscent of the words in the Torah that says HaShabbat, it says Hayom Hagadol Hazeh, Bo Yom Hashem Hagadol VeHanora, Shabbat Hagadol. Now, what does it really say? And who is Elijah? And why are we focusing on Elijah? Eliyahu HaNavi, what's his role? And why do we open a door for him? Well, the tradition has it that Elijah is going to come and announce the coming of the Messiah. That's his job. According to our tradition, he didn't actually die. He was swept up in a chariot up to heaven, and Elijah will come. We are waiting for Elijah to come because he's going to announce, Hinei Anochi Sholeach. And I'll read the very last part of the Haftarah. I will send the prophet Elijah to you before the coming of the awesome, fearful day of the Lord. In Hebrew, Yom Hashem HaGadol VeHanora. Nora is awesome. He shall reconcile parents with children and children with their parents, because as our four children show, children don't necessarily see eye to eye with the parents. There is a generation gap, you know that. So that when I come, I do not strike the whole land with destruction. It ends again with Elijah. Elijah will come and we open the door for him. We prepare a cup. What is that all about, preparing a cup? I know it's wonderful to say that Elijah is going to come to your house and to my house and to, of course, to drink from that cup. Is that true? I'll tell you what the sages actually meant. In the Bible, there are five expressions of redemption. And there is a lot of discussion whether or not the fifth cup should be one of our cups. And because the sages could not come to a decision by the majority, it's called teku. This man, Elijah, will come and he will make the decision whether or not to drink cup number five. It's called a teku. Now we have on our table a cup for Elijah. I do want to tell you that many people have new and different traditions. Some people have decided to drink the fifth cup of wine because the heveti means coming into the land, and we have independence in our own land. So some people have decided to drink. It's not the cup of Elijah that we're drinking. We're drinking a fifth cup. Elijah has not yet come. But so there are innovations. There are new ideas that we incorporate into our tradition. I don't have to tell you that there are differences also between the Sephardic and the Ashkenazim. Different ideas about how how to, the food, of course, and in general, how to dress for the Seder. Are you dressed as if you're ready to go on a trip? Some people are, with a talmil, with a knapsack, and so on. So that's the story of Elijah, and he is in Shabbat Hagadol Haftarah. And so there is a discussion, is the Seder, is someone who attends a Seder, does he have or she have to believe? We need to connect that Seder to Shabbat Hagadol because the children are there and Elijah is, we're waiting for Elijah, of course, to come. And we are really very excited about it. Why are we excited? Because it's the holiday of freedom, it's a holiday of spring, and it's at this time that we await the coming of Elijah. We won't have a lot of time to develop some of the other ideas, but I did want very much to share that part with you. A very quick story of the refusenik, and then something from Rabbi Riskin. Rabbi Riskin is talking, and I think it's important. The very, very beginning of our Seder starts with something called halachma. Halachma anya in Aramaic is saying anybody who's needy should come, and anybody who's hungry should come and join our Seder. I know, once again, that we're not making big sdarim this year, but what does it mean, needy and hungry? Aren't the needy hungry, or aren't the hungry needy? And Rabbi Riskin is saying, no, it's not quite like that. Some people are needy and some people are hungry. What does he mean? He says, sometimes there's hunger. It doesn't mean a lack of nourishment. It can mean hunger for human companionship, for human concern. And of course, some people are lonely or older. And there's a great, great problem in today's world. However, he says, however great the poverty, in the shtetl, there was always companionship. So he continues to say this, the needy are the people who are pressured. They're spiritually confused. The needy are psychologically perplexed. That's where it says, halachma anya diachalu abatana. This is the poor bread. Who's poor? People who have dilemmas that they cannot solve. The lonely, all those who have fallen beneath the wheels of our increasingly demanding and abrasive society. Rabbi Riskin is saying, we need to be aware that some people may have all the food, but they don't have the people to share it with, or they're really quite, quite pressed or oppressed. That is one thing. And he then says, in preparing for the Seder, is this about belief? Is that necessary? Here is what he's suggesting. The Seder is not due to belief in a God who commanded. Rather, the involvement is due to the need to share in common religious or even social experiences, or perhaps out of plain curiosity. Don't suggest that the people who come must believe in it. These Jews are often seekers rather than finders, and they do find God. It is not from the wellspring of belief, but it is from meandering of our history. That's an interesting way of understanding that people need to discover. Therefore, I have a story about that you might really like. And then come back to Mosheino Yodel Yishol. Here's a story. Leonid Riggerman, whose story is but one of the many inspiring tales of the Russian refuseniks. They stood up to be counted as Jews. He was born in Moscow, and Riggerman was raised as a communist and as an atheist, never having entered a synagogue. But one day he chanced upon an English translation of the Bible in the library, and he's thumbing through its pages, and he read the passage about Joseph. He encountered a mysterious stranger. And it says, he's looking at the text, "What are you seeking?" the stranger asked. And Joseph replied, "I am seeking my brothers." Suddenly, tears welled up in the beggar man's eyes, and a yearning arose in his soul. And he says, I too am seeking my brothers. Looking around the library and realizing that no one there was really his brother, he ran directly to the great synagogue, joining a line of people waiting to buy matzah for Passover. Leonid Rigerman went on to become a religious Jew, a refusnik, and one of the great heroes of our generation. He found the Torah and he found his identity, his new identity. I love the story because sometimes Pesach has a way of transforming us. And so I'm coming back to something the Lubavitcher Rebbe says about the children. For him, there's a wise child. Who is he? Well, he probably has European roots, the generation of the grandparents who came to America with steeped in religion. That's probably the wise child. What about the wicked child, says Rabbi Schneerson? He says he was brought up within the American melting pot and he rejected his parents' customs and ways of thought. And this Rasha thought of himself as being in a new country with new ways, and therefore there's a new way of acting. And to him, the parents were terribly old-fashioned and a bit foolish for adopting these ways. Turning his back on the glories of the Jewish tradition, this child often became successful in business, but he was very cynical in his outlook. And then he continues about the third generation, all within one family. Third generation is a simple child. He's altogether confused. He watched his grandfather making kiddush on Friday night and his father was standing by silently, maybe resentfully. And the memory of this grandfather, though strong at our time, is fading. And so the confused, simple child can only say, Mazot, what is this? Caught as he is in the conflict between the grandfather and the father, and finally, the fourth generation. That child doesn't even know how to ask. He's the offspring of the simple child. That's a great tragedy. He was born after his great grandparents had died and he knows only his totally assimilated grandfather and his religiously confused father. And so he's talking about this generation, the generation of the child who thought, and don't laugh about that. You may have heard it though. The generation of the child who thought it was somebody's birthday when she saw her great-grandmother lighting the candles for the holiday. The only time this child had seen candles being lit was on a birthday. She didn't even know how to ask. We are now being challenged to open our great heritage. And at the bottom, it says very clearly, I was actually at a Seder when a child began singing happy birthday, when she saw her great grandmother lighting candles in honor of Pesach. And so it's certainly something to think about. Then we have another comment by Rabbi Riskin about Elijah. He's going to restore the hearts of the children to the parents and the hearts of the parents to the children. That's what we need. We need a new sense of a common language. As Rabbi Saltzman said, keep on having communication. The hearts of the parents to the children and the hearts of the children to the parents, from the prophet Malachi for Shabbat Hagadol. And only when the door is held wide open, think about what it says, only when the door is held wide open, only when we learn to speak to the fifth generation, only when we restore all of them to their lost heritage, shall we be privileged to usher in their completed redemption. Interesting idea about what we must do. And so let me, Song of Songs, I love it. We need songs in our lives. And again, Rabbi Birnbaum is saying, although its meaning has been extended, so what do we know about the Song of Songs? According to our tradition, it's written by King Solomon. It's the very first Megillah, the first scroll in the set of scrolls, first because of the first holiday in the Bible is Pesach. So the first scroll that was assigned for Pesach is the scroll of Song of Songs, in other words, superlative among all the songs. And it is quite the Megillah, but the question is, what is it doing in our Bible? And we'd like to address that as well. It's definitely an atypical book, and we're going to ask Rabbi Kugel a little bit about that, as well as Philip Birnbaum. It says, although its meaning has been extended by various methods of interpretation, because that's the key, are we going to look at the literal interpretation or the spiritual? And obviously, we'll look at both. One cannot miss the beauty of the poem in its literal interpretation. The author takes us with him into the open air, the vineyards, the many songs that we have in Hebrew that stem from there. Lots of songs. El Ginat goes, lots and lots of songs. And finally, he says like that, the Song of Songs has been called a gem of literature. It became an authoritative treasury of word and thought for the mystic's vocabulary. Rabbi Solomon Alkabetz, who composed the song welcoming the Shabbat, and that song is called Lecha Dodi, we know that one, one of the finest religious poetry in existence, used the theme of the Shabbat bride and borrowed the title of his famous hymn from the Song of Songs, because we know Lecha Dodi. Dodi, by the way, is my beloved. And we're going to look at some of the text because it's so beautiful. We need that interpretation. And let's see what Rabbi Kugel says about it. It is really a gem of a little book. So James Kugel, How to Read the Bible, you've heard about it before, is talking about the Song of Songs. And so, just in terms of the language, and you might love to just explore it as poetry. For many people, it's wedding songs that are used. The poetry is gorgeous. It says, it's love between a certain young man and a young woman who are desperately, deliriously taken with each other. This is all the song talks about. Let him give me some of his kisses to drink. The woman begins dreamingly, since love is sweeter than wine. What does Rabbi Kugel say about it, though? What is it doing? What is a poem like that doing in the biblical canon? So we've talked about Rabbi Akiva in the past. Rabbi Akiva is the one who said, well, the Song of Songs is so important. It is like the Holy of Holies. It is in its meaning, the interpretive meaning. It is the love between the people of Israel and God. And according to the tradition, that meeting at Mount Sinai, this is where the ketubah was written. This is the wedding ceremony and the love between the people, that is God being the groom and the people of Israel, that's the bride. In there, so we have Lecha Dodi. This is where we take Anila Dodiva Dodi Li. So Akiva says that the Shir Shirim is the holiest of holy. And so it was inserted into our biblical canon. That's the first of all the scrolls. I'd like to read some of it with you and also to tell you that the song is sometimes shockingly graphic in the description of this couple's embraces. And you'll see by my quotations. What is this song doing? Well, it came to be read as an allegory. And that's the important word to keep in mind. It's an allegory between, and we said, what is an allegory? Well, we need to read it that way. It's in order to understand the symbolism, a lot of things in our biblical writings have meaning. And by the way, that's what we're doing, a whole Seder. We've got all the symbols on a Seder plate, a lot of symbolism, a lot of ideas. So he continues to say, after all, its lush language was often highly metaphorical, and why not read the metaphors differently, as if they refer to the yearning and the frustration of the love that joins human beings with the divine. Did you hear the two words? The yearning and the frustration that join human beings with the divine. Song raises love itself to the very summit of human existence. And so he says, for example, he wanted to quote from the book of Song of Songs. I'd like to quote directly from my volume, share with you, because remember, Pesach is also called Chag Haviv, and tradition says that when spring comes, then the heart of people turn to one another in love. Ana halach dodecha yafa b'nashim, a wonderful, wonderful song, which we love in, here's the English. Whither has your beloved gone, O fairest of women? Whither has your beloved turned? My beloved has gone down to his garden, to the beds of spices, to browse in the gardens and to pick lilies. And then she says, I am my beloved's, and my beloved is mine. Ani le dodi ve dodi li. And he browses among the lilies. You are beautiful, my darling. Turn your eyes away from me, for they overwhelm me. Your hair is like a flock of goats streaming down from Gilad, and your teeth are like a flock of ewes climbing up from the washing pool. Pretty stunning poetry. Just another part. Again, you see an awful lot of nature here. You see the glorification of love. It's erotic. It really portrays a vision of beauty and the vision of the, I guess, the environment in Israel. How lovely are your feet in sandals, O daughter of nobles. Your rounded thighs are like jewels, the work of a master's hand. And then he goes on and on to describe the body, the navel and your belly. And it continues with lilies, and it continues literally describing the beauty in the eyes of the beloved. And then it says again, I am my beloved's, and his desire is for me. Come, my beloved, let us go into the open. Let us lodge among the henna shrubs. Let's go early to the vineyards. Let's see if the vine has flowered, if its blossoms have opened, if the pomegranates are in bloom. Magnificent. Hopefully you'll take the time to look at it. Traditionally, people read it on Shabbat. So I guess that would be the seventh day this year, the seventh day of Pesach, as I told you, by the way. And it's good to remember, next week, next year, Pesach will be a little bit later because it's going to be a leap year. So that's great. Sometimes there's frustration. Somehow she didn't get up fast enough to open the door when her beloved knocks. And Rabbi Soloveitchik uses those words in his essay, which is so masterful. The Song of Songs, a marvelous account of the beauty of Israel, the beauty of love, and the beauty of that relationship. That's what we see here, and there is a lot to celebrate. It says, keep me as a locket on your heart, a signet on your arm, for love is as strong as death and as harsh as Sheol. The flames burn like a fire, a holy conflagration. Deep waters can't put it out, and rivers will not drown it. If a man gave all his wealth for love, would anybody blame him? Just one long metaphor. Its real subject is love between man and God, between Israel, obviously. So in one way, it says that the Song of Songs is the most, says Rabbi Kugel, the most important biblical book in that we deal with. Because, and this is something that you need to consider, we're always looking for interpretation. That's the truth. And so it says, we are looking, it poses the most squarely the question of original interpretation and the original meaning. That's why eventually the religious meaning became the important meaning. But when you read it, you'll enjoy it on many, many levels. That's the book of the Song of Songs, Shir HaShirim Asher LiShlomo. Want to do one more thing. I know the time is late. I'd like to just share with you that Elie Wiesel is telling us, and it's something that we all understand, but we want to be reminded. The Seder is important wherever we may be. It's powerful wherever you live. His fondest memories about the last Seder that he had with his parents before they were all taken away. So what he's saying really is, a nation without a land is still a nation. And the Jewish people are the people of the covenant regardless. That doesn't mean we celebrate and we love our independence. But we should always understand that a Seder is meaningful wherever it is. He likes to tell the story, and you all know that one perhaps, is the Midrash. The victims are saved at the 11th hour, that's the Israelites. Their oppressors drown before their eyes. It's a moment of grace, so extraordinary that the angels decide to begin to sing. But God interrupts them with the most humane, the most generous, the most sympathetic reminder. What has come over you, says Hashem? My creatures are perishing beneath the waves of the sea, and you're singing? How can you praise me with the hymns while human beings are dying? What do we do in order to remember that? We say the 10 makot, the 10 plagues, and we spill some wine to show that we remember that people paid the price of life and death. What about Dayenu, by the way? Is there something that we want to talk about Dayenu? It's another way of saying Hakarat HaTov, something that we need to understand. We are grateful for all the good that has happened. And honestly, you know what? I speak about it all the time. The miracle of survival continues to be the most incredible miracle of all, miracle of miracles. From Rabbi Sachs, and he has a wonderful Haggadah, and I'm, again, just a tiny bit. Pesach is an intensely political festival. Did you think that way? Rabbi Sachs reminds us that it's a political festival. It's about the central Jewish project. What is that? Constructing a society radically unlike any that existed before and most that have come into being since. It poses a fundamental question. Can we make a social order based not on a transaction of power, but on the respect for the human person? Yeah, each person as the image of God. He then continues and he's asking something important. I'd like to share that. The people who survived, I'd like you to consider that. The people who survived, the people who came out, eventually became a nation of visionaries and prophets, right? Well, and scholars and sages, of course. But there was very little in their immediate past to suggest future greatness. In other words, the people who came out from Egypt, they didn't look like they were about to become a great people. There was one thing, though, that was different. A voice heard intermittently since the days of the patriarch, summoning them to a way of life that's quite different. And so he says, holiness is not found in the architecture that's monumental, but in the words and in the teaching. And as you know, he believes so strongly in education. Now, I'm going to save the story for another time, but I do want to suggest, because Pesach is all about questions, I'd like to suggest three things that share with you from Rabbi Sachs. And this is his Haggadah, a lovely Haggadah. There are three conditions for asking a Jewish question. The first is that we seek genuinely to learn. not to doubt or ridicule or dismiss. That is what the wicked son of the Haggadah does. He asks not out of a desire to understand, but as a way of saying, I'm walking away from this. That's number one, a genuine understanding, not to doubt, but to understand. The second of asking a Jewish question, the second one is that we accept limits to our understanding. And he's echoing Maimonides, we have our limits. We do not understand everything. And that's a problem. Not everything is intelligible. There were many scientists, and he goes on and on. And then number three is that when it comes to Torah, we learn by living and we understand by doing. We learn by living and we understand by doing. He finishes this by saying, faith is not opposed to questions, but it is opposed to the shallow certainty that what we understand is all there is. Rabbi Sachs with a lot of wisdom. And so what we want to finish with almost, I know I'd like to finish with another couple of words by Rabbi Sachs. And he's saying that, I think that's the key for us right now. He talks about acts of kindness. He mentions Robert Kennedy. The part I'm going to quote for us is, every good act, every healing gesture lights a candle of hope. Let's keep that in mind. We light a candle of hope in the dark world. One act can redeem a lonely life on the brink of despair. A word of praise can give strength to someone losing the will to carry on. We never know at the time the ripple of consequences set in motion by the slightest act of kindness. There's a lot more about that, but I do want to mention two things that perhaps you already know. It is on the last day of Pesach that we have a ceremony called Isko. Generally, we meet each other in shul. This year, we're going to say Isko for anyone that you may have lost, parents, someone. So Isko is always recited on the last day of the holiday, the second day of Shavuot, the last day of Sukkot. Pesach is coming up and we will say Isko. And that, I think, is very, very meaningful. That's another way for us to have our memories and to focus on our memories. And so finally, I'm going to quote about poetry. I think, again, consider just sitting down and taking in this gorgeous love poetry, because songs and music is very much part of the Haggadah. I don't know whether you know it, but for some people, there's a tradition to read the Song of Songs right after the Seder. I don't know if you finish at 2 o'clock, but whatever. And of course, among the Sephardic people, the Song of Songs is recited each and every Friday. And you'll notice that they know every word off by heart, having heard it again and again. So the Song of Songs is really an open book for many people. And I think that it's a huge celebration. That's why we want to visit and really take in some of the beauty. Rabbi Sachs says the religion hears the music beneath the noise, because we have a wonderful tradition of music and poetry. And what are the Psalms if not all of that? And you know what? We're saying Hallel at night. Generally, we say Hallel only in the morning, but we say Hallel during the Seder, which is simply, simply glorious, because we're saying B'tzet Yisrael Mimitzrayim, when the Jews left Egypt. We're saying all the familiar and lovely ones. Let's just sing that one and then we'll be able to close. Yevarech et Beit Yisrael, Yevarech et Beit Aharon, Yevarech Yirei Adonai, Haktanim im Hagdolim, Yosef Adonai Alechem, Alechem ve'al Benechem, ברוכים אתם לאדוני, עושה שמיים וארץ, השמיים שמיים לאדוני. והארץ נתן לבני אדם, לא המתים יהללויה. To end it, before we actually say thank you to Alan and thank you to everyone, most of all, I really want to wish you and yours a marvelous Chag, a Pesach kasher v'sameach and filled with joy. And so let's end with a couple of words that say, we use poetry and song and rituals that bind us together and stories that gather us into a set of shared meaning. All of this is part of our religion. We relate as people in a world of persons, free agents in a world of freedom. That is where we meet God. Very powerful. From the Great Partnership by Rabbi Sacks. And so it is that to end it all, let me tell you, Dayenu means, what does Dayenu mean? Is it enough? It's another song of gratitude. God, you've done all this for us and we thank you. That's Dayenu. Focus on the good. That's what it says. It's not really enough. We want more. So let's finish with the beautiful words of the Song of Songs. I know I've said that before. I'm a rose of Sharon, a lily of the valley. Like an apple tree among the trees of the forest, so is my beloved among the young people. How wonderful are your kisses, my sister, my beloved. That's, your kisses are sweeter than wine and your fragrance better than all perfumes. What did they see? That allegory, the allegory of wonderful love between the people. And yet, there's of course called the deed of fek. Maybe my beloved is knocking. Maybe we sometimes don't open the door at the right time and we may miss an opportunity. For another time, that's called the deed of fek. Thank you again and Chag Pesach Sameach.
Todi li vani lo aroe bashoshanim mi zotola min hamidbar mi zotola mi zotola min hamidbar mi zotola Shoshana.